right, so right, I'm going to be talking about Gaussian graphical models, and please stop me if I, you know, if you have any questions. Hopefully, I'm just going to give you an overview, and I'm only going to focus on a couple of different ideas. Graphical models in general is just a huge area, so I'm just going to focus on one type and one type of that one type. So you'll see. All right, so what is a graph? Well, a graph is a mathematical object defined as a pair of vertices and edges. And so each edge is associated with a pair of nodes, which are the endpoints, and they may be undirected, directed, or bidirected. The kind of graph I'm going to focus on for this talk are undirected graphs. And so nodes are represented by circles, and for undirected graphs, they're just going to be a single line. So that's what this alpha line beta is, just an undirected graph between nodes alpha and beta. And so there are lots of packages in R that you can that can be used for graphical modeling, DRBase, RGraphViz, and you can create an undirected graph using the UG function. So here we're creating an undirected graph with nodes A, B, B, C, D, and E, vector notation, and this is what we get. So we you see that B, C, D, A, B, and E hanging out by itself. And you can just call the plot function and it'll plot it for you. And by undirected, as you can see, it's just a line. There are no arrows or anything. Okay, so there are different things called complete graphs. So I'm just going to go over a little bit of terminology. There's lots of terminology when it comes to graphs, but this is just a little sampling. We'll start with a subset A of a set of vertices where it's complete if all those vertex pairs in that subset A are connected by an edge. And a graph is called complete if the vertex set that it has is complete. And you have a maximal complete subset called a clique to say that a complete, which is a complete subset that's not contained in a larger complete subset. So cliques hold all of your complete subsets in the set of cliques. So here, yeah, see, it's supposed to say complete is dot complete, but things got weird with the PDF from the RPres. But is our undirected graph complete? And you would have something that says is dot complete, and UGO, it would tell you false is the first one, and is dot complete UGO, we're looking at just BCD, the subgraph, and that's true. So that's what that's supposed to say. And as you can see, this whole graph isn't complete, but this subset BCD is. Okay, and then this is just the graph again. What are the maximal cliques? Oh yeah, no, it's just got weird. I tried to, hopefully it won't look so weird throughout the thing, but you can call maximal cliques, and that tells you what all the maximal cliques within the set of cliques. So BCD, BA, and E are all of the maximally complete cliques, as we can see. All the complete subsets is not contained in a larger subset, so it's the set of all of that. All right, so this is separation, even though the S got dropped. We are talking about a path of length n between alpha and beta in an undirected graph, which you have a set of vertices. And so it's just basically just any path between any nodes. You go from one node to another node, and that's called a path. And if it circles back, so that's what this is saying, alpha equal beta, that's called a cycle. And so a subset D and V is an undirected graph that separates, is said to separate A from B if every path between a vertex in A and B contains a vertex D. So here we're asking, does BC separate A and D? And here it's supposed to say true. And so if we can look back, BC is separating the A and D nodes. And so that's what that's telling us. And so you can ask, you know, use the package and it'll tell you what nodes separate what. And so conditional independence in graphs. So we have a collection of random variables with a joint density. A, B, and C are subsets of V, and we have X of A, which has a set of vertices within this within the set of A and B and C. And so we basically what we're saying is XA and XB are conditionally independent given XC. That means that for every possible value of XC, XA and XB are conditionally independent. So you look at one set of variables and another set of variables, you can say they're conditionally independent given some other set, basically. That's what that's saying. And you can use a factorization theorem to show that, which we all are very aware of, so that's what that's saying. And so that tells us that, you know, the XA and XC are independent from XB and XC, and you can write functions with respect to those joint densities, which is nice. And so we'll see why. Oh gosh, I'm so sad that this is happening. Density factoring according to a graph, factorization according to a graph. So we have these parametric models that may be thought of as specifying a set of joint densities. So they give rise to conditional independence relationships between the variables. So that's how we represent, that's what the undirected graph does. It represents conditional independence relationships between variables. And we use the factorization theorem as our mathematical tool to show this. So we have our undirected graph, and we've got those cliques that I talked about, where we're talking about maximally complete subsets of the graph, or just complete graphs, and we've got our joint density, and we can have a factorization with respect to those cliques. And so it's the same thing. We can talk about conditional independence. So X sub j depends on X only through some other X sub clique, basically. So F factorizes according to a graph G. That's what that's saying. Okay, this is supposed to say global Markov property. Yes.
Can you give me an example, so just wrapping around like an application of, the only time I've seen them used was with a forced example where like team abilities versus each other. I'm just trying to put all the definitions that I thought about.
Yeah, so later I'll talk about prediction and regression, but that basically this can be formulated into a regression problem. At least the Gaussian graphical model can, and the other ones too, but essentially, what we can say is if certain variables are, if you can say two variables are independent given all the other variables in the model, if one of those variables are one that you're interested in, then maybe you can drop the other one that's conditionally independent. So you can use it for like variable selection problems, basically. So that's what I do, what I use it for. So I try to, it's like you have a set of variables, you're not quite sure how they're related. You want to see, use this graph to show relationships between them. And then the ones that seem to be related, those are the ones that you might pursue further and like try to learn more about them. And the ones that aren't, the ones that have no edges, maybe drop them from like a prediction model, or just, you know, leave them for another time to learn about or something. So basically it's like I would use it as a variable selection model, or use it for variable selection or prediction. Yeah. Yeah, so the global Markov property basically tells us that if you have this model that factorizes according to G, then G encodes those conditional independence, the conditional independence structure. And so whenever sets A and B are separated by another set, A and B is conditionally independent given that set on the model. And so global Markov property is basically used for all graphs. It's used in undirected Gaussian graphical models. This is like one of those tenet properties that is used to justify what, like, all the analyses you do for a graph. So A is conditionally independent of D given B is what that's supposed to say. So this tells us we can separate A and D from B, and that's true. And so because we can separate it, A is conditionally independent of D given B.